In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. God sent John the Baptist to tell about the light, so that everyone might believe. John himself was not the light, he was only a witness to the light. The one who is the true light, who enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. But although the world was made by him, the world misunderstood him. He came to his own people and was not accepted. But to all who accepted him and believed on his name, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn. This is not a physical birth from human passion or plan. This rebirth is from God. So the Word became flesh and lived here on earth among us. He was full of grace and truth, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son of the Father. No one has ever seen God, but his only Son, who is himself God, is near to the Father's heart. He has told us about him. It all begins with a Jewish priest, Zechariah, who lived when Herod was king of Judea. Zechariah was a member of the priestly order of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also from the priestly line of Aaron. Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous in God's eyes, careful to obey all of the Lord's commandments and regulations. They had no children because Elizabeth was barren, and now they were both very old. One day Zechariah was serving God in the temple, for his order was on duty that week. As was the custom of the priests, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary and burn incense in the Lord's presence. While the incense was being burned, a great crowd stood outside praying. Zechariah was in the sanctuary when an angel of the Lord appeared, standing to the right of the incense altar. Zechariah was overwhelmed with fear. But the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah, for God has heard your prayer, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to name him John. You will have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice with you at his birth, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or hard liquor, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. And he will persuade many Israelites to turn to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and power of Elijah, the prophet of old. He will precede the coming of the Lord, preparing the people for his arrival. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and he will change disobedient minds to accept godly wisdom." Zechariah said to the angel, "How can I know this will happen? I'm an old man, and my wife is also well along in years." Then the angel said, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. He sent me to bring you this good news. And now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be unable to speak until the day that the child is born, for my words will certainly come true at the proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah to come out, wondering why he was taking so long. When he finally did come out, he couldn't speak to them. Then they realized from his gestures that he must have seen a vision in the temple sanctuary. He stayed at the temple until his term of service was over, and then he returned home. Soon afterward, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and went into seclusion for 5 months. "How kind the Lord is," she exclaimed. "He has taken away my disgrace of having no children." In the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Mary was troubled by what he said and tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be frightened, Mary," the angel told her, "for God has decided to bless you. You will become pregnant and have a son, and you are to name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can I have a baby? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby born to you will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she's already in her 6th month, for nothing is impossible with God." Mary answered, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it happen to me as you have said." And then the angel left. A few days later, Mary hurried to the hill country of Judea, to the town where Zechariah lived. She entered the house and greeted Elizabeth. At the sound of Mary's voice, Elizabeth's child leaped within her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Elizabeth shouted to Mary, "You are blessed by God above all other women, and your child is blessed. I am honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me. When you came in and greeted me, my baby jumped for joy the instant I heard your voice. You are blessed because you believed that the Lord would do what he said." And Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He hath showed strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He hath helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever." Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months, and then went back to her own home. Now Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph when she became pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Joseph, being a just man, decided to break the engagement quietly so as not to disgrace her publicly. As he considered this, he fell asleep, and an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not be afraid to go ahead with your marriage to Mary, for the child within her has been conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All of this happened to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet: "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded. He brought Mary home to be his wife, but she remained a virgin until her son was born. The time came for Elizabeth's baby to be born, and it was a boy. The word spread quickly to her neighbors and relatives that the Lord had been very kind to her, and everyone rejoiced with her. When the baby was 8 days old, all the relatives and friends came for the circumcision. They wanted to name him Zechariah after his father, but Elizabeth said, "No, his name is John." "What?" they exclaimed. "There's no one in all your family by that name." So they asked the baby's father, communicating to him by making gestures. He motioned for a writing tablet, and to everyone's surprise, he wrote, "His name is John." Instantly, Zechariah could speak again, and he began praising God. Wonder fell upon the whole neighborhood, and the news of what had happened spread throughout the Judean hills. Everyone who heard about it reflected on these events and asked, "I wonder what this child will turn out to be, for the hand of the Lord is surely upon him." Then his father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and gave this prophecy. "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins. Through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace." John grew up and became strong in spirit. Then he lived out in the wilderness until he began his public ministry to Israel. At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who was big with pregnancy. And while they were there, her time for childbirth came. She gave birth to her first child, a son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the village inn. That night some shepherds were in the fields outside the village, guarding their flocks. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel said, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy for everyone. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born tonight in Bethlehem, the city of David, and this is how you will recognize him. You will find a baby lying in a manger, wrapped snugly in strips of cloth. Suddenly the angel was joined by a multitude of heavenly beings, praising God, saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to all whom God favors." When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this wonderful thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They ran to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. Then the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. Everyone who heard the shepherds was astonished, but Mary quietly treasured these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their fields and flocks, glorifying and praising God for what the angels had told them, and because they had seen the child just as the angel had said. 8 days later, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel before he was conceived. Then it was time for the purification offering, as required by the law of Moses after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. The law of the Lord says if a woman's first child is a boy, he must be dedicated to the Lord. So they offered a sacrifice according to what was required in the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man named Simeon who lived in Jerusalem. He was a righteous man and very devout. He was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he eagerly expected the Messiah to come and rescue Israel. The Holy Spirit had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. That day, the Spirit led him to the temple, so when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord as the law required, Simeon was there. He took the child in his arms and praised God, saying, "Lord, now I can die in peace. As you promised me, I have seen the Savior you have given to all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." Joseph and Mary were amazed at what was being said about Jesus. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, "This child will be rejected by many in Israel, and it will be their undoing. But he will be the greatest joy to many others. He will be an omen that will be resisted, so that the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul." Anna, a prophet, was also there in the temple. She was the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher and was very old. She was a widow, for her husband had died when they'd been married only 7 years. She was now 84 years old. She never left the temple, but stayed there day and night, worshiping God with fasting and prayer. She came along just as Simeon was talking with Mary and Joseph, and she began praising God. She talked about Jesus to everyone who had been waiting for the promised king to come and deliver Jerusalem. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We have seen his star as it arose, and we have come to worship him." When Herod heard these things, he was deeply disturbed, as was all of Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and scribes. "Where did the prophet say the Messiah would be born?" he asked them. "In Bethlehem," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.'" Then Herod sent a private message to the wise men, asking them to come see him secretly. He learned the exact time when the star appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me, so that I too can go and worship him." After this interview, the wise men went their way. Once again the star appeared to them, guiding them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house where the child and his mother Mary were, and they fell down before him and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But when they left, they went home another way, because God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. After the wise men were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up and flee to Egypt with the child and his mother," the angel said. "Stay there until I tell you to return, because Herod is going to try to kill the child." That night, Joseph left for Egypt with the child and Mary, his mother, and they stayed there until Herod's death. This fulfilled what the Lord had spoken through the prophet, "I called my son out of Egypt." Herod was furious when he realized that the wise men had outwitted him. He sent soldiers to kill all the boys in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under, because the wise men had told him the star first appeared to them about 2 years earlier. Herod's brutality fulfilled the prophecy of Jeremiah. A cry of anguish is heard in Ramah, weeping and mourning unrestrained. Rachel weeps for her children, refusing to be comforted, for they are dead. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and told him, "Get up and take the child and his mother back to the land of Israel, because those who were trying to kill the child are dead." So Joseph returned immediately to Israel with Jesus and his mother. But when he learned that the new ruler was Herod's son, Archelaus, he was afraid. Then, in another dream, he was warned to go to Galilee. So they went and lived in a town called Nazareth. This fulfilled what was spoken by the prophets concerning the Messiah. He will be called a Nazarene. There the child grew up healthy and strong. He was filled with wisdom, and God's grace was on him. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for Passover. When Jesus was 12 years old, they attended the festival as usual. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth, but Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents didn't miss him at first because they assumed he was with friends among the other travelers. But when he didn't show up that evening, they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they couldn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to search for him there. 3 days later, they finally discovered him. He was in the temple, sitting among the religious teachers, listening and asking questions, and all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. His parents didn't know what to think. "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been worried, searching for you." "But why did you need to search?" he asked. "You should have known that I would be in my father's house." But they didn't understand what he meant. Then he returned to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them, and his mother stored all these things in her heart. So Jesus grew both in height and in wisdom, and he was loved by God and by all who knew him. Jesus was about 30 years old when he began his public ministry. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius, the Roman emperor, Pilate was governor over Judea, Herod Antipas was ruler over Galilee, and Annas and Caiaphas were the high priests. A message from God came to John, son of Zechariah, who was living out in the wilderness. John went from place to place on both sides of the Jordan River, preaching in the Judean wilderness. His message was, "Turn from your sins and turn to God, because the kingdom of heaven is near." Isaiah had spoken of John when he said, "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God." John's clothes were woven from camel hair, and he wore a leather belt. His food was locusts and wild honey. People from Jerusalem and from every section of Judea and from all over the Jordan Valley went out to the wilderness to hear him preach. And when they confessed their sins, he baptized them in the Jordan River. When the Jewish leaders sent priests and temple assistants from Jerusalem to ask John whether he claimed to be the Messiah, he flatly denied it. "I am not the Messiah," he said. "Well, then, who are you?" they asked. "Are you Elijah?" "No," he replied. "Are you the prophet?" "No." "Then who are you? Tell us, so we can give an answer to those who sent us. What do you have to say about yourself?" John again quoted Isaiah, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord." Then those who were sent by the Pharisees asked him, "If you aren't the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet, what right do you have to baptize?" John told them, "I baptize with water, but among you in this crowd is someone you do not know, who will soon begin his ministry. I am not even worthy to be his slave." This took place at Bethany, a village east of the Jordan River, where John was baptizing. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming to be baptized, he denounced them. "You generation of vipers," he exclaimed, "who warned you to flee God's coming judgment? Prove by the way you live that you have really turned from your sins and turned to God. Don't just say we're safe, we're the descendants of Abraham. That proves nothing. God can change these stones here into children of Abraham. Even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever your roots. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire." The crowd asked, "What should we do?" John replied, "If you have two coats, give one to the poor. If you have food, share it with those who are hungry." Even corrupt tax collectors came to be baptized and asked, "Teacher, what should we do?" "Show your honesty," he replied. "Make sure you collect no more taxes than the Roman government requires you to." "What should we do?" asked some soldiers. John replied, "Don't extort money, and don't accuse people of things you know they didn't do, and be content with your pay." Everyone was expectantly wondering whether John might be the Messiah. John answered everyone by saying, "I baptize with water, but someone is coming who is so much greater than I that I am not even worthy to untie his shoe. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He is ready to separate the chaff from the grain with his winnowing fork. Then he will clean up the threshing area, storing the grain in his barn, but burning the chaff with never-ending fire. John used many such warnings as he announced the good news to the people. John also publicly criticized Herod Antipas, ruler of Galilee, for marrying Herodias, his brother's wife, and for many other wrongs he had done. For this, Herod soon put John in prison, adding this sin to his many others. Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, but John didn't want to baptize him. "I am the one who needs to be baptized by you," he said, "so why are you coming to me?" But Jesus said, "It must be done, because we must do everything that is right." So then John baptized him. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, and I am fully pleased with him." John pointed Jesus out to the people. He shouted to the crowds, "This is the one I was talking about when I said someone is coming who is far greater than I, for he existed long before I did." We have all benefited from the rich blessings he brought to us, one gracious blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. God's unfailing love and faithfulness came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but his only Son, who is himself God, is near to the Father's heart. He has told us about him. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. For 40 days and 40 nights he ate nothing, and afterward was hungry. Then the devil came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, change these stones into loaves of bread." But Jesus told him, "No. The Scriptures say, 'Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. The devil told him, "I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus replied, "The Scriptures say, 'Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve.'" Then the devil took him to Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple, and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. For the Scriptures say, 'He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered, "The Scriptures also say, 'Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.'" When the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came, and angels came and cared for Jesus. One day, as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out where it's deeper and let down your nets, and you will catch many fish." "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and caught nothing. But since you tell us, we'll try again. And when they did it, their net caught so many fish that it broke. They called their partners in the other boat, and they filled both boats with fish to the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Lord, please leave me. I am a sinful man." For he was awestruck by the size of their catch, as were the others with him. His partners James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. Jesus replied to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people." A little farther up the shore, he saw James and John sitting in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them to come too. And immediately they left their father in the boat with the hired men, and as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. The next day Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Come, be my disciple." Philip was from Bethsaida, Andrew and Peter's hometown. Philip went off to look for Nathanael and told him, "We have found the very person Moses and the prophets wrote about. His name is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" "Come and see for yourself," said Philip. As they approached, Jesus said, "Here comes an honest man, a true son of Israel." "How do you know about me?" Nathanael asked. And Jesus replied, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip found you." Nathanael replied, "Teacher, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel." Jesus asked him, "Do you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than this." Then he said, "The truth is, you all will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The next day, Jesus' mother was at a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee. Jesus and his disciples also were invited to the celebration. When they ran out of wine, Jesus' mother spoke to him. "They have no more wine," she said. "How does that concern you and me?" Jesus asked. "My time has not yet come." But his mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." 6 stone water pots were standing there. They were used for Jewish ceremonial purposes and held 20 to 30 gallons each. Jesus told the servants, "Fill the jars with water." When the jars had been filled to the brim, he said, "Dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies." So they followed his instructions. When the master of ceremonies tasted the water, which had been made into wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. "Usually a host serves the best wine first," he said. "Then when everyone is full and doesn't care, he brings out the less expensive wines. But you have kept the best until now." This miraculous sign at Cana in Galilee was Jesus' first display of his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After the wedding, he went to Capernaum for a few days with his mother, his brothers, and his disciples. It was time for Passover, and Jesus went to Jerusalem. In the temple, he saw merchants selling cattle, sheep, and doves for sacrifices, and he saw money changers behind their counters. Jesus made a whip of ropes and chased them all out of the temple. He drove out the sheep and oxen, scattered the money changers' coins over the floor, and turned over their tables. Then, going over to the people who sold doves, he told them, "Get these things out of here. Don't turn my father's house into a marketplace." Then his disciples remembered this prophecy from the scriptures, passion for God's house burns within me. What right do you have to do these things? The Jewish leaders demanded. If you have this authority from God, show us a miraculous sign to prove it. All right, Jesus replied. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. What? They exclaimed. It took 46 years to build this temple, and now you can do it in 3 days. But Jesus meant the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, the disciples remembered that he'd said this, and they believed both Jesus and the scriptures. Because of the miraculous signs he did in Jerusalem at Passover, many people were convinced that he was indeed the Messiah. But Jesus didn't trust them because he understood everyone. No one needed to tell him about people, for he knew what was in them. After dark one evening, a Jewish leader named Nicodemus, a Pharisee, came to speak with Jesus. Teacher, he said, we all know that God has sent you to teach us, for no one can do such miraculous signs except by God. Jesus replied, I assure you, unless you are born again, you can never see the kingdom of God. What do you mean? Said Nicodemus. How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? Jesus replied, The truth is, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. People can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives new life from heaven. So don't be surprised when I say that you must be born again. Just as you can hear the wind, but can't tell where it comes from or where it is going, so you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. What do you mean? Nicodemus asked. Jesus replied, You are a leader in Israel, and yet you don't understand these things. I assure you, I am telling you what we know and have seen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.